dear participants. Nice to be sitting with the colleagues who are working on fluorosis. Indu and then Sundar. And they started this Jerbo model of fluorosis mitigation. And I am trying to understand this disease for more than 3-4 decades. You all know that I am a neurosurgeon by profession. You might wonder that how the hell a neurosurgeon is interested in fluorosis problem. You all know that in skeletal fluorosis, late stages, they would come. So in late 60s, when I came, then I was operating on these patients. Most of them you could improve to some extent, but I realized that fluorosis is a disease that got to be prevented rather than treated. Because how well you operate on the spinal cord compressions, you could never make them normal. Then I was just trying to understand what is this disease, and then you all know, of course, fluorosis is a disease caused by excessive ingestion of fluoride. Earlier, of course, everybody was thinking it is only the water and nothing else. But you all know that significant amount comes from food and, of course, from both water and food. And this is widely prevalent, really. And now they say that these are 275 districts out of 626 odd in the country are affected by fluorosis. Almost one third of the country. In 20 states, you have this problem. And 66 million people are living in these areas. And they are at the risk of contracting fluorosis. And they say that at least 6 million Indians are known to be crippled because of fluorosis. Just, you know, you feel terrible that that kind of a problem wasn't a national health problem till few years back. Only we were, you know, crying wars in the last many years, just 2 or 3 years back. The health department took it up as a, you know, one of the health problem, but very little money is there and very little, you know, things are happening and so on. Well, just to understand the disease, you know, how can we can control the disease? Only if we understand the what are the, you know, things that cause fluorosis. And it is just not, you know, water alone. It is just not the food alone. Health, I mean, nutrition does play a significant role. We just explained to you how and so on. It was in way back in 1937, first time in the world came to know about that an entity called endemic skeletal fluorosis. And this was mainly because of Pandit and Raghavachari. These were the two people who were the health officials in Nellore district. Before that, they only knew about dental fluorosis, but nothing more than that. But whole skeleton was affected and all that. And they were the ones who took those cases to Madras. Sharp was the professor of medicine in Madras General Hospital. And he did this next. Extensive study and so on is a classic description of the disease, how it starts from teeth and then slowly over a period of 20, 30 years, then skeleton starts to get affected. And at that time, the clinical presentation of the disease he explained to me nicely and so on. And also, he said at that time, because most of the cases which he has examined, they had kidney disease. Majority of the patients he said was had a kidney disease. We are just trying to understand why this kidney disease and what is the significance of his observation and so on. Next. And you all know that it starts with teeth because 96-99% of the fluoride retained in the body retains in the skeleton, just like calcium, 99% of calcium is in the bones. Similarly, that it is the skeleton which gets affected. Of course, optimum amounts of fluoride you take, it is good for the teeth, incidence of caries is much less. And incidence of senile osteoporosis is much less. So these are the beneficial effects of fluoride. Only when we take excessive, we have these problems and so on. Next, we go on to. And this is the continued use of the excessive amounts of fluoride over a period of years causes this kind of a skeletal changes and so on. And these are the things from the Nalgonda district and where And we have, you know, other observations too. Well, first we had a national symposium in 1974. It was by the Usmania Medical College and the Geological Survey of India. At that time, we wanted to take stock of what is this disease, how common it is, and how it is caused. We are geologists, dentists, and every veterinarians were there, all the neurosurgeons were there, and those of us who were operating and medical people were there and so on. Next. At that time it was said that it is only in two pockets. One is in the North Punjab and Haryana area, and then in the South in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka adjacent Tamil Nadu. Only 25-30 million people are at risk, and half a million are people. And in 99, by the time that UNICEF said that 200 and odd districts are affected now in 20 states, and 6 million are people. And by 2009, government of India puts out this report that 275 districts. So what is obvious is that it is not only because of the shot and others, people saying it, you become more aware of it, you are aware of the disease, but it is just not that. Disease is spreading, and disease also becoming more severe and so on. And next slide. And you all know that in every, you know, state in this government of India puts out this, in Assam you have got two districts, and fluoride level is 1.6 to 23 in our state. You have got sometimes places as high as 29 and so on. So it is obvious that why the fluorosis is common in our country, because groundwaters do contain excessive amounts of fluoride. And what is, you know, is excessive, we will talk about it, and what are the other factors that we will talk about. Next slide. And fluoride, of course, you know, is an halogen, and fluorine, of course, doesn't occur in free form, and fluoride is a very common element and so on, and it is present in everything we eat and drink. So some people, sometimes politicians say that, you know, we are going to give you fluoride-free water, it is just not possible at all. So everything what we, you know, drink, whether in beverages or anything at all, every food just contains that. So just in order to try to understand this disease, next slide. And this was a wonderful work which was done way back in 1940. So when they knew the disease was there, what they did was in the whole coastal belt of Madras Presidency, they estimated thousands and thousands of samples and so on. Next slide. And they found out that except in this belt, fluoride levels were not high at all. And Kodili, Garsin, Kangiri areas, they were fluoride level and severe case of fluorosis were there. And the entire belt, the fluoride levels were less than one. Next slide. And at that time, they were surprised that even in the area, the triangular area, where the cases of severe fluorosis have come from, skeletal fluorosis was grossly affected, fluoride levels were only the 1 to 3. And they were rarely exceeded 6 people. And they wondered that in England they were drinking 6 parts per million in Malden, no one has got a skeletal fluorosis. And in Texas, even then, even today too, when Obama became the president for the first time, Bush went to Midland. And Midland people have been drinking water containing 2.5 to 4.6. Actually, 10, 20 years back, Mississippi River has, water has come on. Now it is a little better. 10 people. And Anand is practicing for 35 years. Not a single one in that town of 100,000 have a skeletal fluorosis. And here, we have got in Prakasham, we have got 1 to 3 ppm. And Siddhi, the great man who wrote in BMJ, I will talk to you about it. 1 ppm drinking man developed spinal cord compression, which he treated. Authority on fluorosis. So there are, these are the factors we got to understand. Otherwise, we just can't contain the disease at all. Next slide. And then this was the first report which has come on. WHO got interested because at that time they said that 25-30 countries had this fluorosis. And this was the first report. And Siddiqui also is there. Some Indian scholars are there. And then this is a classic book, and we understood what is fluorosis, how it, all that dental fluorosis and skeletal fluorosis. next slide. And that time they said was, even 1970, 5 ppm of fluoride, no asbestos fluorosis. Only 8 ppm, only 10% in incidence. So even that WHO didn't have the clear concept of the disease like, you know, we know about now. Next slide. So 1940 alone, Pandit and Raghavachari did this wonderful. They just wanted to find out 1-3 ppm single strand of fluorosis and so on. So what are the causes? So they picked up few villages, and Dirshavancha was an ideal village because it has got small village about 600-700. Next slide. And they studied the topography, everything and so on, nutrition of every single individual in that village to understand the causes of fluorosis. Next slide. And then they studied weaver, agriculturist, county, dhoti and so on, their diet, economic conditions and all that, just trying to understand the disease. Next slide. And then they said that there was a disparity in the incidence noted, fluoride levels were same. No, we know we have the answer for that. Some areas, you have got a strontium is high, even the fluoride levels are same, incidence is different and so on. Economic and nutritional surveys were carried out. They say that incidence and severity of the disease had a definite relation to economic and nutritional status of the community. This was very significant. And also they said diet deficient, also vitamin C deficiency. So what have we learned from this study of that at that time we tried to, you know, say that why the incidence is high, even the fluoride levels are 1-3. Temperatures are very high, 115-116, you drink a lot naturally, your intake is a lot more. It's the laborers who are getting more affected because they sweat a lot and so on. But nutrition, they know that something plays a role, but it was all said that it was only because of their occupation and so on. And kidney disease, they didn't talk about it, but now we know and we are working on that. Next slide. And then Nalgonda, 1945. They were set first time in Nalgonda. Nalgonda has a high levels of fluoride, going up to 25, 26 and so on ppm. And then he said that nutrition has a significant, is a significant factor. He said that at that time. And Siddiqui's was a classical and British medical journal. And one thing that has come out of it, that he described the disease and all the things. Calcium intake was exceptionally low. He said, they were studied in all those cases. Intake of calcium was around 300 milligrams. So that is significant for our, you know, observation. And then this started to come out in 70s, this limb deformities, which weren't there earlier. Same areas, 1945, 55, Genu Valgum, all those deformities were not the same areas. Weather has not changed, occupation has not changed. But new problem has come on now, and they call it a Genu Valgum. And then, you know, it was the diet and significance of all those are important. Next, what had happened during this interim was, in the villages of that area, a lot of changes have happened. Okay? The selling of milk and vegetables. Earlier, you know, village would just consume all that. Nobody would sell milk those days and vegetables those days. Fertilizers have come on, bore wells have come on, and then tea drinking has become common. And so earlier there would be no bottle at all in the village in 1940s and 50s. No, the tea drinking has become common. And then, of course, every one of the reports also confirmed that nutrition, rural nutrition especially, is very bad. Next slide. And why the nutrition is significantly deteriorated is that this is this girl, she has got a Genu Valgum, she started to become worse, she can't even walk in her 15, 16, teens.
It is her father.
And they were drinking from the same well, food is the same and so on. And then he got crippled only in his 50s. And this is God. So this is, you know, very clear that really rural nutrition has deteriorated. Next slide. And Nalgonda, from what we know, that it is the disease severe in laborers, diet does play a role. In calcium intake is very low. And then, of course, all those things have happened. Excellent. And of course, NMB reports you all know about that 60% of children are underweight, and one third of them significantly so. And whatever that Government of India's programs are there, they have been a big failure in improving the nutrition. Excellent. And these charts, they come out, you know, there are lots of them. And just look at the calcium intake in rural children from the Government of India reports and so on. This is 10 to 12 year old girls, growing girls. Optimum is 800 milligrams, at least no less than 600 milligrams. And actually foreign, they say that more than 1,000 is optimum. And no state, nowhere in rural areas, they are getting up the amount of calcium. Next slide. And these are things you know about. Severe amount of malnutrition is there, and anemia continues to be there. Next slide. And then these, you know, all this Government of India spending money and so on, but neither the anemia or malnutrition has improved at all. Next slide. And this is a significant study which has come on from China. And they said everything was similar in that village. All were drinking, weather was same, occupation was same, everything was there. Incidence of skeletal fluorosis, individuals with normal nutrition was 43%. And then individuals with deficient nutrition was 69. And deficient nutrition means what? Less than 75 grams a day of protein and 600 milligrams a day of calcium and so on. So that diet and nutrition does play a significant role here. Next slide. And in this village, why I put up this? He's from Hanumantapuram village and so on. He surveyed hundreds of those villages. This village, you see that severe skeletal fluorosis is there. And of course, water means doesn't mean only just fluoride levels and so on. We checking for nitrates and total dissolved solids. And we've been checking 65 trace elements in hundreds of water samples with ICP-MS method and so on. We were just trying to, I was mainly interested was why the kidney disease is high in certain areas. And then just the weather, occupation are the only factors. What other factors are there for the severity of the disease in that part when they were drinking only 150 mg of fluoride and so on. And in this village came out was strontium was exceptionally high and so on. Anything more than 500 ppb is supposed to be abnormal. And in that village, they are drinking up to almost 10,000. So the strontium does play a role in some of those villages. So hundreds of samples we tested, quite a number of the villages. Aggravation of the fluoride toxicity is in addition to strontium. Strontium, calcium, and fluoride are bone-seeking elements. And I want to produce bone changes. I feed strontium to the animals, exactly the changes will be similar to fluoride. These days, osteoporosis treatment, they started with fluoride. Now they are giving strontium all over the world to strengthen the bones and so on. So strontium exactly acts like fluoride. So it aggravates and so on. Next slide. And this village, why I taken up Meripal? This village has a high incidence of kidney disease. It's just like any other village in that Prakasham district and so on. And then we were just trying to understand, fluoride levels are not too high at all. And that sample she collected for me, fluorides, TDS were a little higher, nitrates were okay, but fluorides were only just 1.5. Then why the disease is very common in that village? And then why the kidney disease is very high? Next slide you take up. And 1 year, so many died of kidney disease, out of only 1,200, 1,300 they live in the village. So high incidence of kidney disease. So chromium is high, that can damage the kidneys. Uranium is high, that can cause kidney problems. In addition to that, in that village, I have a bad habit. For aches and pains, they just consume analgesics. So we are just not. Another factor we found in another villages was silica is higher, they have got high kidney disease. Experts are talking. Come in.
Please watch.
Then in 2002, World Health Organization, in between, lot of new information has come about fluorosis. Then they brought out this volume in 2002. Next slide. And here they said was food as well as water, because earlier everybody was talking only water, water, nothing else. And so politicians thought that you just give them water, it's going to go away. Rashakriya, our former CM, was there. I said, you have something about fluorosis? Oh, we are doing everything. Because he thought that water, you know, things, programs he started, that would answer that and so on. And they also said that a person's diet, general state of health, as well as body's ability to dispose of fluoride, kidney function, these are all important and so on. It is just not the fluoride leveling. Next slide. And so, what were the difference and so on? Earlier we said 1970 predominantly water related. Now food and water, both are equally important. In some villages which we have tested long back, 80%, 50 to 60 milligrams of fluoride they were getting a day in Nalgonda villages, Yella Reddy Goda. And when we see 80% was coming from food, because locally grown food they eat. Of course, air problem is only in Chen, not with us. And earlier they used to say that, oh, only when you take more than 20 milligrams is bad, but now they say that even more than 6 milligrams is. And nutrition, they never talked about it, but Pooja said nutrition does play a role in sleep. Next slide. And then of course, we had a second conference. This was conference is significant because some of you are going to talk about this arsenicosis. They were all discussed in this 2004 Nagpur conference. And at that time, not only fluorosis, there were other diseases which were due to abnormal mineral contents and so on, arsenic, as well as silica and other things causing filarial, sort of a legs. We used to think that elephantiasis was because of the mineral things. So now we are realizing that abnormal contents of minerals are responsible for some of the diseases and kidney disease in certain areas and all. And this village we went, because Dirshavanja I told you was examined. And it's one village, we can sit there, everybody we could see that and so on. We should spend 2-3 days and so on. So this village got water for 13 years, Krishna water, idea. And when we went, seen that village, all of the children, every one of them had dental fluorosis. At least younger fellows, if they had got Krishna water, they should have had fluorosis at all, dental fluorosis. And next slide. There's hardly any difference. 1940 we compared that. Of course, education facilities have improved, many people moved from the village. And then Krishna water has come on now. But when it comes to dental scalp fluorosis, it hasn't made a difference at all. So it means that you only think about water, nothing else. Then I think we are not going to control this problem. Next slide, please. And then that village. And again I went back in 2011. Next slide. And then we've seen that those who are well off, their nutrition is good, they left the village, they were well off. Those who remained in the village, every one of them would develop scalp fluorosis. Even today, in the water they are getting Krishna water. But of course, supply is, you know, irregular and all that. Nutrition, of course, is not good. Next slide. So, solutions are there. Next slide. And then, significant amount of this calcium is that everybody wondered that Nalgonda, why they have up to 20 in their study, but higher levels too. They said that low calcium content of rocks and soils, and of course presence of sodium bicarbonate in soils are responsible for high levels and so on. Calcium is low, then you get more into the fluoride and so on. Calcium is optimum, less is absorbed into the human body. So calcium is very, plays a significant role and so on. And of course, with optimum calcium reduces the amount of fluoride absorbed and deposited in the calcium. And of course, calcium, magnesium, I did extensive studies on animals. Just you fix the fluoride in the body and it gets eliminated. So magnesium that way is useful. Vitamin C, how it plays a role, we don't know it, but somehow it lessens the severity of the disease and so on. Next slide. So yeah, this is our teaching. Neither government of India approach is terrible. And this is 2007 issue. So everyone have read 700-page book. Next slide. And such a problem affecting 500,000 Indians. And this was only half page, only little water. Nalgonda technique failed everywhere. But medical students still read that. And probably only Raja Reddy was reading that. Then he said that everything we need, little water, and then fluorosis is going to disappear. And that was, you know, won't be able. Next. So government efforts were in the wrong direction because they were only concentrated on just how to provide them with water. If wherever you can't, then have these plants and so on, you know, all that. They spent hundreds of crores. Instead of that, they given them a glass of milk to every student and so on, a child in the villages. The problem they have been, you know, contracted. And all these, you know, defluoridating plants, they are hot and then just lie around the landscape of Nalgonda district. Next. So how to treat this prevention? Of course, I must be one way updated on maximum number of these spinal cases in the world. Because wrote textbooks, international textbooks and all that. Yes, you can help them to some of them, but you can never make them completely normal. So the disease got to be prevented gradually. And so many other factors are there. Now we are understanding this is climate, occupation, nutritional status. So we are going to talk about. And of course, kidney function still, I think, little British were working on it. And then other factors, and of all, German fellow asked me to write a book on fluorosis, but not in Indian published. Mm-hmm. So this was, you know, when German fellow invited me, and then the book has come out, and then it is available on the net, and Amazon and all that, and so on. So now with all this knowledge and so on, we were all talking about it in Sundar. And you know, all of us, Leela and all. Then we said, how best to do it, you know, take up a project. And then these Jabo villages have been selected. And then, you know, we are going about in a detailed way and how to, you know, provide them with good water and then good nutrition and so on. Excellent. And then, of course, these children, they're all malnourished, tribal people. Excellent. And then, you know, they're all chlorotic, they are from the and then their serum levels, urine levels confirm that they are severely fluorotic. Next one. And, you know, all the continued, the ability to check up this tell us that they are suffering from severe skeletal fluorosis. Next. And then, just look at that. Not one of the child's BMI is normal. So all are men. Some of them are, you know, significant, so on and so on. And then the next is, you know, this kind of next is when you first look at them. Chinese said in late 70s, 1980, first time, they said, oh, super osteoporosis is the earliest manifest of fluorosis. All textbooks said that it is osteosclerosis. I myself wrote intuition textbooks and so on, sclerosis. That time, China went through a terrible time. There were severe malnutrition, millions died and so on. And that kind of picture is not there now. But that same picture which China has seen, that though we are seeing today in Jabua. And now, next slide. Mm-hmm. These are all skeleton, osteoporotic, and then the bending of the limbs. Next slide. And when calcium intake is much less, then parathyroid hormone hyperactivity is there, then secondary hyperparathyroidism, you know, all the bones become weaker and so on. Next slide. Next slide. And of course, we have just time to estimate the fluoride content of all the foodstuffs they have eaten. Next slide. And based on all these, of course, with our experience of other villages, many villages, and now we have formulated a policy of, you know, trying to control the skeletal fluorosis. So, you know, we now know that nutrition does have a significant role in supplements. But of course, yeah, I took a little more time. And I thought not that, you know, we are still trying to understand the disease, but I think a lot more things we know about, and I think about nutrition.